tonight we're starting Bill's story, and I'm an alcoholic. My name's Doug. My sobriety date is August 17th, 1990. With any luck, about another month or so, I'll have 20 years. Now, Bill's story is 16 pages. It's chapter 1, starts on page 1. The bad news is the first 6 pages of Bill's story are drunkalogue. But, you know, I've always said one of the things I've maintained throughout my sobriety is I just, if I find any lacking in my ability to teach the steps to others, it would be somewhere in the first step. Because I've just, for me, my experience with the first step was, I don't know what to say other than I got it from alcohol, and I really didn't do a whole lot of reading. Or I understand the idea that, you know, in the doctor's opinion there, that the obsession followed by the allergy once we pick up the first drink. And I, whenever I have one of my sponsees who doesn't make it, that's the first thing I think is maybe I should have, you know, spent a little more time on the first step. But like I said, I don't believe that any amount of book smarts will give me or anybody else the first step. It can only come from a bottle. But in these first, we'll try to get through these 6 pages here, so the first half of this chapter. And on page, like, 7, he begins talking about his, it's when the sobriety and the steps start to kick in Bill's story here, where he begins to talk about his being placed in this rehabilitation center. And he starts talking about Dr. Silkworth and his recovery and his relapses. But in these first 6 pages, he's going to be talking about his drinking. And I guess we're expected to be tuning into step 1 here for the next 6 pages. And like I said, if I had any problem with my sobriety, it would be, I'd need to redouble my efforts at trying to teach the first step. But I don't know. I do the same thing with some people, and they stay sober as I do others who get drunk. So, you know, what does he say? If a man is to find God, the desire must come from within. Okay, this is Bill's story, chapter 1. I'm not going to be able to do a whole lot of, that's why I was bringing that up, I'm not going to be able to do a whole lot of commenting on what we're reading here, because it's mostly, you know, set in this October 29, 1930, 31, 32, and that period, and, you know, that's a little before my time. And a lot of the terms used and phrases and stuff. Anyway, Bill's story, chapter 1, page 1. War fever ran high, and the New England town to which we new young officers from Plattsburgh were assigned, and we were flattered when the first citizens took us to their homes, making us feel heroic. Here was love, applause, war, moments sublime with intervals hilarious. I was part of life at last, and in the midst of the excitement I discovered liquor. I forgot the strong warnings and the prejudices of my people concerning drink. In time, we sailed for over there. I was very lonely and again turned to alcohol. We landed in England. I visited Winchester Cathedral. Much moved, I wandered outside. My attention was caught by a doggerel on an old tombstone. Now, he says there, much moved, and he refers back to this later on as part of his spiritual experience that he has. He refers back to my time in that old time in Winchester Cathedral. So apparently he just makes a brief mention of it here, but it was pretty profound. It was kind of like, you know, he's facing death here in World War One, I guess it was. This was back in before World War Two. So, I mean, all this stuff takes place before the 1940s. But that much moved is referred to later on. Here lies a Hampshire grenadier who caught his death drinking cold small beer. A good soldier is near forgot whether he dieth by musket or dieth by pot. So that cold small beer, you know what that was? I was watching a show recently about bottled water, modern bottled water. And in the old days, there wasn't a whole lot of filtered water going. There was no filtered water. All you got was water that they got out of the river, the lakes, the pumps, the whatever, the wells. And they may have boiled it or something, but for the most part, you would drink water and get to, you know, go to the bathroom for 2 or 3 days, and water was very dangerous back then, not like it is now. We take it for granted. So what they would do is they would make this real light version of beer with just a little bit of alcohol in it, and that little tiny bit of alcohol would kill the bugs in it that would not make you so. It was almost like drinking water. That's what he's talking about when he says drinking cold, small beer. That didn't mean they were sitting around drinking beer. That means that was the form of water that they were drinking, in a sense. It's almost like something like that near beer that they have today. Anyway, ominous warning, which I failed to heed. 22 and a veteran of foreign wars, I went home at last. I fancied myself a leader, for had not the men of my battery given me a special token of appreciation, my talent for leadership, I imagined, would place me at the head of some vast enterprises which I would manage with the utmost assurance. I took a night law course and obtained employment as an investigator for a surety company. The drive for success was on. I'd proved to the world I was important. My work took me about Wall Street, and little by little I became interested in the market. Many people lost money, but some became very rich. Why not I? I studied economics and business as well as law. Potential alcoholic that I was, I nearly failed my law course. At one of the finals, I was too drunk to think or write. Though my drinking was not yet continuous, it disturbed my wife. We had long talks when I would still her forebodings by telling her that men of genius conceive their best projects when drunk, that the most majestic constructions of philosophic thought were so derived. By the time I had completed the course, I knew the law was not for me. The inviting maelstrom of Wall Street had me in its grip. Business and financial leaders were my heroes. Out of this alloy of drink and speculation, I commenced to forge the weapon that one day would turn in its flight like a boomerang and all but cut me to ribbons. Living modestly, my wife and I saved $1,000. It went into certain securities, then cheap and rather unpopular. I rightly imagined that they would someday have great rise. I failed to persuade my broker friends to send me out looking over factories and managements, but my wife and I decided to go anyway. I had developed a theory that most people lost money in stocks through ignorance of markets. I discovered many more reasons later on. We gave up our positions and off we roared on a motorcycle, the sidecar stuffed with a tent, blankets, and change of clothes, and three huge volumes of financial reference service. Our friends thought a lunacy commission should be appointed. Perhaps they were right. I had some success at speculation, so we had a little money. But we once worked on a farm for a month to avoid drawing on our small capital. That was the last honest manual labor on my part for many a day. We covered the whole eastern United States in a year. At the end of it, my reports to Wall Street procured me a position there and the use of a large expense account. The exercise of an option brought in more money, leaving us with a profit of several $1,000s for that year. For the next few years, fortune threw money and applause my way. I had arrived. My judgment and ideas were followed by many to the tune of paper millions. The great boom of the late 20s was seething and swelling. Drink was taking an important and exhilarating part of my life. There was loud talk in the jazz places uptown. Everyone spent in thousands and chatted in millions. Scoffers could scoff and be damned. I made a host of fair-weather friends. My drinking assumed more serious proportions, continuing all day and almost every night. The remonstrances of my friends terminated in a row, and I became a lone wolf. There were many unhappy scenes in our sumptuous apartment. There had been no real infidelity, for loyalty to my wife, helped at times by extreme drunkenness, kept me out of those scrapes. In 1929, I contracted golf fever and went at once to the country, my wife to applaud, while I started out to overtake Walter Hagen. Liquor caught up with me much faster than I caught up behind Walter. I began to be jittery in the morning. Golf permitted drinking every day and every night. It was fun to carom around the exclusive course which had inspired such awe in me as a lad. I acquired the impeccable coat of tan one sees upon the well-to-do. The local banker watched me whirl fat checks in and out of his till with amused skepticism. Abruptly, in October 1929, hell broke loose on the New York Stock Exchange. After one of those days of inferno, I wobbled from a hotel bar to a brokerage office. It was 8 o'clock, 5 hours after the market had closed. The ticker still cleared, still clattered. I was staring at an inch of tape which bore the inscription XYZ-32. It had been 52 that morning. I was finished, and so were many friends. The papers reported men jumping to their death from the towers of high finance. That disgusted me. I would not jump. I went back into the bar. My friends had dropped several million since 10 o'clock, so what? Tomorrow was another day. As I drank, the old fierce determination to win came back. Next morning, I telephoned a friend in Montreal. He had plenty of money left and thought I had better go to Canada. By the following spring, we were living in our accustomed style. I felt like Napoleon returning to St. Elba, returning from St. Elba. Or no, I'm sorry. From Elba, no St. Helena for me. But drinking caught up with me again, and my generous friend had to let me go. This time we stayed broke. We went to live with my wife's parents. I found a job, then lost it as a result of a brawl with a taxi driver. Mercifully, no one could guess that I was to have no real employment for 5 years, or hardly draw a sober breath. My wife began to work in a department store, coming home exhausted to find me drunk. I became an unwelcome hanger-on at brokerage places. Liquor ceased to be a luxury. It became a necessity. Bathtub gin. 2 bottles a day, and often 3, got to be the routine. Sometimes a small deal would net a few $100s, and I would pay my bills at the bars and delicatessens. This went on endlessly, and I began to waken very early in the morning, shaking violently. A tumbler full of gin, followed by a half a dozen bottles of beer, would be required if I were to eat any breakfast. Nevertheless, I still thought I could control the situation, and there were periods of sobriety which renewed my wife's hope. Gradually, things got worse. The house was taken over by the mortgage holder. My mother-in-law died, and my wife and father-in-law became ill. Then I got a promising business opportunity. Stocks were at a low point of 1932, and I had somehow formed a group to buy. I was to share generously in the profits. Then I went on a prodigious bender, and that chance vanished. I woke up. This had to be stopped. I saw I could not take so much as one drink. I was through forever. Before then, I had written lots of sweet promises, but my wife happily observed that this time I meant business, and so I did. Now, that idea right there, I have to tell you, that the idea of swearing it off, for me, you know, that when I came into Alcoholics Anonymous, I wanted to control my drinking. I don't know about you guys, but I had to do a little of my own testing. And for me, like I said, step one is the idea that we're trying to get out of these pages here. I just wanted to stop for a minute. And, you know, I'll do another page or page and a half, and then we'll get to that part where he brings up his recovery from then on. Because there's only like one more time when he drinks after that part where he gets confined to this hospital by his mother-in-law. Or brother-in-law, I'm sorry. But anyway, I woke up. This had to be stopped. I saw I could not take so much as one drink. I was through forever. Before then, I had written lots of sweet, but this, my wife happily observed, was the last time I meant business, and so I did. I think it was about 2 years after I actually did that I came crawling into AA, that I actually said I do not want to take another drink. And I used to actually, it's almost like I would just see myself. I think that the thought came into my head that I was going to the bar to hang out and I wasn't going to drink. And I was, what? How insane is that? I'm going to go hang out in the bar. And then once I would get a drink, I'd say, I'm only going to have one drink. And then once I would have one drink, I would say, oh, what the hell? I'm here now. We'll try it next week. That happened to me for like 2 years straight, to where I could not. It's the insanity that we're talking about is the alcoholic insanity, and that's the insanity that I experienced. That's how it came into my life, was I would always tell myself, I'm only going in the bar to hang out. I mean, hell, I ain't got nowhere else to hang out. I'm only going to hang out in there. And for me, I swore I wasn't going to take a drink. And once I got in there, it's almost like, you know, you get this feeling inside that, oh, what the hell, it's over now. I'll just have one. But anyway, shortly afterward, I came home drunk. There had been no fight. Where had been my high resolve? I simply didn't know. It hadn't even come to mind. Someone had pushed a drink my way, and I had taken it. Was I crazy? I began to wonder, for such an appalling lack of perspective seemed near being just that. Renewing my resolve, I tried again. Some time passed, and confidence began to be replaced by cocksuredness. I could laugh at the gin mills. Now I had what it takes. One day I walked into a cafe to telephone. In no time, I was beating on the bar, asking myself how it happened. As the whiskey rose to my head, I told myself I would manage better next time. But I might as well get good and drunk then, and I did. I hate to say it, but I know some guys out there who've been doing this for a better part of 20 years, and I wish I had the answer as to why I came up with the willingness to. I have to tell you, my sobriety all boiled down to a yes or a no question when I was either in jail and they said, "You want to go to the drug cells and rehab cells?" Was it yes or no? And I go, "Oh, okay, yeah." And then on my way out the door, it was, "You want to go to the halfway house or back to the streets?" Okay, yeah. That's how my sobriety pretty much happened for me. I mean, other than the fact that the like Bill Wilson states later on, his sudden and profound spiritual experience, I had something similar to that. And from that day on, and for me, like I said earlier, my experience with it, and that's all I'm trying to convey to you guys is, you know, when you've got a sponsee sitting in front of you, and they ask you, "Will you please help me? You've got some sobriety time. What can you do for me?" The only real thing that I can come up with is to try to relate to them what it was that happened to me, so that maybe I could help induce into them, like Bill Wilson helped Dr. Bob understand that the fatal nature of his disease, and that was the turning point. Because he says Dr. Bob had always thought he could beat the alcohol game on his own somehow. He always thought there was some kind of angle, and even though he was bouncing in and out of the Oxford groups for 2 years, it said, for 2 years. So he was in the Oxford groups longer than Bill Wilson was. He was bouncing in and out of the Oxford groups in Akron, Ohio, and it wasn't until he met Bill that Bill helped convey the message to him of the hopelessness and the, what, you know, Silkworth's allergy or obsession followed by the allergy ideas. But anyway, once again, back to where, you know, it all boils down to this for me. My sobriety boils down to trying to help another alcoholic understand how to get what it is that Bill and these first 100 are trying to convey to us. And the best way, I heard a man say one time, you know, if you try to explain to another person the 12 steps from someone else's point of view, and how they've experienced it, it's going to be disingenuous, and it's not going to be the actual 12 steps. And so much as if I explain it to them the way that I experienced it, the way that I can look back in my life and what it was that happened to me, and you know the idea here that Bill's getting, that he swore it off, and I'd look around and I'd say, "I'm in this bar again. What the hell happened? A couple of minutes ago, I was three blocks up the street going home, and now I'm sitting in this bar again." And I got to tell you, it was almost like I had nothing to drink, I had nothing to smoke, I was completely clean and dry, and I was in some sort of blackout almost, to where I walked into the bar instead of home, and it's the only way I can explain it was. But, you know, like I said, I have a little lacking when it comes to the first step. I usually, because, you know, both sponsors jumped me right to step four. The first guy I met said, "We're going to sit down and write a list of the people, everybody you know." He didn't say a resentment list. He said, "Just put everybody's name down, and we'll get to that when you do the names." But anyway, back to the reading. The remorse, the horror, and the hopelessness of the next morning are unforgettable. The courage to do battle was not there. My brain raced uncontrollably, and there was a terrible sense of impending calamity. My first sponsor used to say that all the time. Impending doom is what he said. That fear of impending doom. He called it, what the hell was it he called it? I'll think of it in a minute. It's one of those psychiatric words. I hardly dared cross the street lest I collapse and be run down by an early morning truck, for it was scarcely daylight, and all night places supplied me with a dozen glasses of ale. My writhing nerves were stilled at last. A morning paper told me the market had gone to hell again. Well, so had I. The market would recover, but I wouldn't. That was a hard thought. Should I kill myself? No, not now. Then a mental fog settled down. Gin would fix that. So two bottles and oblivion. So it's obvious he's had the thought of killing himself here. I got to tell you, I had that thought too, but I never really like said, "Oh, I'll kill myself." It was like in the back of my head, like, "I'm out of here. I'm out of here. The hell with this." The mind and body are marvelous mechanisms. For mine endured mine endured this agony 2 more years. Sometimes I stole from my wife's slender purse when the morning terror and madness were on me. Again, I swayed dizzily before an open window or the medicine cabinet where there was poison, cursing myself for a weakling. There were flights from this city to country and back as my wife and I sought escape. Then came the night when the physical and mental torture was so hellish, I feared I would burst through my window, sash and all. Somehow I managed to drag my mattress to a lower floor. So here he is thinking about suicide again, going to throw himself out a window. Twice he mentions it. Somehow I managed to drag my mattress to a lower floor. At least I suddenly leap. A doctor came with a heavy sedative. Hey, wait a minute. We don't talk about those things in here. Next day found me drinking both gin and sedative. This combination soon landed me on the rocks. People feared for my sanity. So did I. I could eat little or nothing when drinking, when I was 40 pounds underweight. My brother-in-law is a physician, and through his kindness and that of my mother, I was placed in a nationally known hospital for the mental and physical rehabilitation of alcoholics. Under the so-called belladonna treatment, my brain cleared. Hydrotherapy and mild exercise helped much. Best of all, I met a kind doctor who explained that though certainly selfish and foolish, I had been seriously ill, bodily and mentally. So that's the first mention of sobriety here. I mean, the beginnings of his time spent with Dr. Silkworth here. Best of all, I met a kind doctor who explained that though certainly selfish and foolish, I had been seriously ill, bodily and mentally. It relieved me somewhat to learn that in alcoholics, the will is amazingly weakened when it comes to combating liquor. Though it often remains strong in other respects, my incredible behavior in the face of desperate desire to stop was explained. Understanding myself now, I fared forth in high hope. For 3 or 4 months, the goose hung high. I went to town regularly and even made a little money. Surely this was the answer, self-knowledge. But it was not. For the frightful day came when I drank once more. Now, that self-knowledge thing, I was in rehab. I'm going to open up the floor for open discussion here in a minute. And we'll read the rest of this 16 pages in this chapter, so that'll give us 9 pages. Or hell, once he starts into the recovery, I can slow down a lot because I can get to like one paragraph or something, spend 10 minutes talking, because he gets into all the steps here in the forwards, these next few pages, 15, 13. Those are the pages with all the steps on it and the way he experienced them. Anyway, self-knowledge. There was a lot of that when I was in the rehab that I went to. I have to tell you, there were these mandatory meetings, and one of the things that I've noticed about myself and about other people is that there's hard work. Number one, there's hard work involved in getting sober and staying sober. And I'm talking about it when my sponsor said to me that giving was the answer, you have to give of yourself. I remember this was like 12 or 13 years ago, and I said, I have nothing. What can I give? I'm like nobody. I live from paycheck to paycheck almost. I'd be lucky to have a few thousand in the bank. And he said, no, you're not talking about giving money. We're talking about giving your time. You have to give your time to other people. When someone says, will you help me, my first thought was, well, I got to do this. I got this happening that day, and really, I'm not going to have time for you. And you see, that's when my sobriety kicks in. And what I was referring to was, backing up with this self-knowledge idea, was it boiled down to, my sobriety boiled down to that moment in my life when someone says, will you help me? And that's what I try to convey to my sponsees. I say, there's another thing that I did early on too, was I avoided being an attractive person for sponsorship in meetings. There's a way that you can sit in a meeting and no one will ever ask you to sponsor them. And that's like an excuse. You come up and go, hey, I would have sponsored people if somebody had asked me, but, you know, nobody ever asked me to sponsor them. But if you look in the book here, we're instructed to go out and find doctors, priests, ministers, and rabbis and search out these people to work with. And nobody does that anymore, but what we do is we sit in meetings and we wait for somebody to ask us to sponsor them, to help them through the steps. And one of the things that happened to me several years back was I had spoke at a meeting, I think it was Central House, you know, I don't know, 12, 13 years ago. And there must not have been very many sober people around there. I had talked about the steps, spirituality, God. I knew I hated talking about myself. I think the first couple of times I spoke, I focused on where I was born, where I grew up, where I went to school, and I couldn't, I felt like crap afterwards. I didn't like it. So I switched over. Unlike Bill here, he talks a lot about the drinking, and I think there's a reason for that, and my sponsor heard me speak, and I didn't say anything about drinking, and he said, well, there's a reason for that, and that reason is that you don't want the people in the room to think that you're just some guy who ain't got nothing else to do with his time, you know, my life is so boring. I never really had a real drinking problem. I just thought I'd come in and hang out here because this is one of the places some people hang out. You want to acknowledge the fact that you're a real alcoholic and that you have your message carries depth and weight because, you know, you got a certain amount of time and you were a real alcoholic. You had, it was two choices for me, die or get sober. That's what it boils down to. But this idea of self-knowledge... Back to what I was getting to was I was in the rehab and we had all these counselors and it always seemed to me that they would show us these videos. They'd go, okay, tonight's lesson, we're going to play a video for you, and I'd stick a video and they'd walk off. They would not sit down with us. They wouldn't take the time to try to explain anything to us. And no, they were all recovering alcoholics themselves. I'm not trying to badmouth them. All I'm saying is I look back on it and I used to think, you know, it made me angry. And now today I see them, I say, you know, they couldn't transmit something that they didn't have. And though there was a lot of stuff that went on in there that was questionable, I came out of there sober, and I haven't had a drink since. And I thank the world of the place. They helped me. And several other people that I knew stayed sober several years after that. But the self-knowledge is the tapes they used to play us. They used to have these doctors stand there and explain to us what the effect the alcohol has on the body, on a molecular level, what alcohol does to the brain, blah, blah. And they would, man, they would... For years, I thought that was good stuff. I go, man, this is the answer. We just get enough of this knowledge about what's happening to me and how these things affect my brain and the effects that alcohol has on the human body and, you know, the whole mechanical aspect of it. And it really, it means nothing, absolutely nothing. It's real cute stuff, but it means nothing. And the sad part was they thought it did for some reason. I don't know. But anyway, I'm going to continue next week with when we start get into Bill's step one is on the next page, page 8. And so we'll get right into the steps with him. You know, no words can tell of the loneliness and despair I found in that. So we got Bill's drunk log out of the way. I have to tell you, Bill's story is one of my favorite parts in the whole book because it's got the most basic idea of Alcoholics Anonymous, and that is that one alcoholic is going to drink. He's on the edge of a drink. He's done for. My time is over as a sober alcoholic. I'm going to drink. But wait, I find somebody to work with. I give of my time. I try to help somebody with, you know, genuine concern. And from the way that it makes me feel inside about who I am, of giving of myself, it keeps me sober. It takes me out of myself. It takes me away from the obsession for that first drink. And, you know, there's not a whole lot of the detail of the obsession. You'll find it in the fourth step, and you have to really go into the mechanics of the fourth step to see that fear is at the root of the obsession for that first drink. All fear is based in self, and we get out of that self-based fear by doing things for others. And it's a real simple idea, but it's best seen in three areas that I know of. A Vision for You, the entire chapter is all about Bill meets Bob, he's on the edge of a drink, he helps Bob stay sober, he stays sober. And so too is Bill's story. Bill's story is essentially, he's on the edge of a drink, it's the same story. And forward to the second edition, the whole, you know, the details of that story are in there, some of the time frames are in there, like he had 6 months of sobriety when he met Bob, he was on the edge of a drink. He had failed to sober dozens of people because he was speaking down to them from a spiritual hilltop, and Silkworth explained to him you know, you're speaking down to them. You got to get down to their level and try to help bring them up instead of being up at your level and saying, come up with me, sort of, you know, that sort of thing. But next week we will continue with the Bill's steps, and I don't know, we'll try to get 3 or 4 pages, because like I said, the steps are really quick when you get to page 13. It's like step 3 through 11 on that one page, page 13. And I like to slow down when I'm getting into those pages and to see the breakdown, we made a list of people I had hurt and toward whom I had felt resentment. You know, the fourth step, my schoolmate visited me, talking about Abby Thatcher. And his third step, I humbly offered myself to God. I admitted for the first time that of myself I was nothing. Without him, I was lost. Anyway, so we'll open up the floor for the second half of the meeting for open discussion. If you'd, you know, we're focusing on step one here, and the smashing of the ego, the deflating of the human ego. Anyone like to share on anything we just read tonight? Hey.